And Barrett, as we say hello to you, it's good to have you back. Anything going on this college football season that we may have missed?
Oh, you know, Clemson just regressing back to what it was in the early part of this decade. And, you know, Arkansas finally realizing that it can actually play top-level football. Just a few things. You know, it's interesting, though, Paul, because, you know, it's not the same old, same old. A lot of casual sports fans are getting their wish. You know, different blood, different storyline.
It is the same old in controversy coming out of Auburn, though, a school you know and love well. I'm really leaning on you here because, I mean, Brian Harsin is still new in the job, and you know there are a lot of things to like about him. But that game Saturday was very disturbing on many fronts, and I'm really curious your takeaway from that game and what it all means now.
I think for Harsin, it's a kind of a tipping point in terms of where the season goes, because they looked uninspired. They looked like they were a disjointed football team and that they really had no fire. And, you know, credit to, I guess, to Harsin for putting in T.J. Finley, but more credit to T.J. Finley for not only sparking the offense, but I think, you know, kind of putting some fire into the entire team to not let the unthinkable happen. So, it is odd, and then to follow it up with the firing of a wide receivers coach 4 games into a stint as a head coach at a program, very odd. And I, you know, for Harsin, it's not something that we've seen from him, so it makes me think that maybe there is some more pressure, and that he's trying to handle it internally as quickly and as efficiently as possible. But that the pressure exists and is very Auburn in the most Auburn way. So look, I think he'll be fine. I just think that it's going to be a learning process, and he has to figure out how to sort of manage the ancillary things around that program that are more complicated than at most programs.
Yeah. And speaking of complicated programs, that's where Auburn heads to on Saturday night. And yeah, you can come out of the game LSU won at State any way you want if you're an LSU fan. You got the Stingley question up in the air. You've got Coach O almost breathing, exhaling. But you know, let's look at that program as well. And not that I need to remind you how high you were on the LSU Tigers.
Or maybe I was just high. I don't know.
That's a good excuse.
Either way. It was, yeah, I think LSU, look, it's very fragile. I think that there was a lot to compare to the 2012 Auburn Tigers, because 2 years removed from a national championship, 1 year removed from a disappointing season, you know, you're kind of on that brink teetering. And, yeah, I thought they'd win the West. I thought they'd be really, really good. Clearly, that does not look like it's the case right now. And a big reason for that is the fact that they really can't run the football. And, you know, part of that was John Emery not being available, but still, you're LSU. You should be able to run the football at a reasonably high level, no matter who's back there. And for Ed Orgeron, look, this is the first big game since that UCLA loss. You know, Mississippi State, I don't think anybody really, felt threatened by this particular Mississippi State team. And then, you know, Central Michigan, McNeese State, you know, whatever. So this is a big test, because if Ed Orgeron fails at this, if they lose to Auburn for the first time since 1999, then yeah, things could absolutely go south in a hurry. And that's not to say that Ed's on the hot seat right this very second, and maybe not even after a loss like this, if it were to happen, but it could definitely lead to more things down the road that conceivably could put him on that hot seat and maybe make LSU consider making a change after the season.
And Barrett, that just still seems shocking to hear. And I'm not playing games here, because I covered very closely what happened to Chizik in 2012, and it just collapsed. And Matt Stinchcomb mentioned the A&M game where they just got blown up, and it never he could never recover after that. And I don't know whether, you know, this game always seems to be a tipping point, though. And that's why I think fans of both programs watch this game so closely every year. We all know what happened 4 years ago.
Oh, yeah, 2016, the buyout bowl, where Danny Etling conceivably wins the game, at least in theory, and at least according to the referees on the field. But turns out they got the snap off a half second too late, and Auburn wins, and Les Miles gets fired the next day. When, you know, had the initial call stuck, then maybe it was Gus Malzahn getting that pink slip the next day. So, yeah, it is the game is so entrenched, and it's so it consistently provides so many odd storylines, from coaching changes to fires to hurricanes to earthquakes to all that stuff. Heisman moments for a guy like Cam Newton. You know, it's one of the more exciting and one of the most watchable games. And the fact that it's at 9 o'clock Eastern time in Death Valley is just going to make it so much fun. But there always is a residual effect from this game in one way, shape, or form. And I think in this particular one, from a coaching perspective, you're looking at, okay, does Ed get on the hot seat? And if you're Brian Harsin, okay, are you the guy that finally stops this streak? Because that would be a feather in his cap. And then also for Auburn, who's the starting quarterback? Because if they go down there and win, whoever it is, whether it's Bo Nix or TJ Finley, they're going to be person's going to be the starting quarterback moving forward.
Thanks for watching ESPN on YouTube. For live streaming sports and premium content, subscribe to ESPN+.